Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
There are so many precious promises given in the Spirit of Prophecy concerning this subject that it would be impossible to read them all. Hopefully I'll have a little time we can read a few from this book, My Life Today, which is a morning watch book. Let's see, when was this published? It's published in 1952. My Life Today, it's a compilation of morning watch books, a compilation of statements that were made by Ellen White. But first, I would like to go over a number of promises with you in the Bible, and it would be well for you to have these promises in mind so that when you get into trouble, you know where the help is and how you can get it and you can ask for it. And remember, God stands behind every promise that He has made. He stands behind every one. Every one of these promises is for God's children to claim when they are in difficulty. And these kinds of promises do not begin in the New Testament. There are many wonderful ones in the Old Testament. And if you have your Bible, I'd like to invite you to open it to the book of Deuteronomy. Now this, the book of Deuteronomy was at the end of the 40 years of wandering when Moses reviewed the law with the children of Israel a second time. It was just before his death. The last chapter in the book of Deuteronomy is not written by Moses. We don't know who wrote it. But the last chapter in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 34, talks about Moses' death on Mount Nebo. But if you look in chapter 33, Deuteronomy 33, in Deuteronomy 33, we have Moses' final blessing for Israel. It says in verse 1, now this is the blessing with which Moses, the man of God, blessed the children of Israel before his death. And there are many wonderful promises in this chapter, these blessings that Moses gave to the children of Israel just before his death. I'm going to read only from the blessings that were promised to Asher. Now, these blessings were promised to all of God's children. But starting in verse 24, it says, Asher is most blessed of sons. Let him be favored by his brothers, and let him dip his foot in oil. Your sandals shall be iron and bronze. As your days, so shall your strength be. There is no one like the God of Jeshurun, who rides the heavens to help you, and in his excellence on the clouds. The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. He will thrust out the enemy from before you and will say, destroy. He goes on to say that the Lord is the shield of your help in verse 29. Now, there are some promises in this blessing to Asher that Ellen White quotes many times. One of them is in verse 25, as your days, so shall your strength be. As your days, so shall your strength be. In other words, you're going to receive the strength that you need for the experience that you're going through. Hopefully we'll read a couple of promises where Ellen White quotes this text. As your days, so shall your strength be. Another one is in verse 27. It says, the eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. So, that's a wonderful, wonderful promise. As your days, so shall your strength be, underneath are the everlasting arms. God is never going to leave you. Next, let's go to the book of Psalms. There are many, many wonderful promises in the book of Psalms. Look first of all in Psalm 9. Psalm 9. Starting in verse 7. But the Lord shall endure forever. He has prepared his throne for judgment. He shall judge the world in righteousness, and he shall administer judgment for the peoples in uprightness. The Lord also will be a refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. And those who know your name will put their trust in you, for you, Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. So, the Lord doesn't forsake those that seek him, and he's a refuge for those that are oppressed in times of trouble. There are many promises in Psalms. Look at Psalm 50. Psalm 50, verse 15. It says, call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. We're not going to read through either Psalm 46 or Psalm 91, but Psalm 46 and Psalm 91 are prophecies that describe specifically the experience of God's children during the times of final trouble. Psalm 91 describes the experience of God's children during the time when the plagues are poured out. And Psalm 46 describes the experience of God's children right at the end of the time of trouble, because it talks about the mountains being carried in the midst of the sea. That happens during the seventh plague. So Psalm 46 describes the experience of God's children right at the end of the time of trouble. And Psalm 46 contains many, many wonderful promises. And then let's go to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 26. It says, verses 3 and 4, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for in Yah," that's Yahweh, that's a short for Yahweh or Jehovah, first part of the word, "is everlasting strength." I don't know about you, that's a text sometimes when you're going through trouble, you're laying awake at night, you quote it all night long because you need help and you can claim the promise, Lord's promise to keep you in peace. There's many wonderful promises in the book of Isaiah. Look at Isaiah 43. My wife had a relative who about a little over 40 years ago was burned to death in a car accident. And his mother found great comfort in this promise. This is what it says. Isaiah 43, starting with the second verse. "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I gave Egypt for your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in your place." So, the three Hebrew worthies, of course, knew that passage of Scripture, and they told King Nebuchadnezzar that God could save them from being burned in the fiery furnace if it was His will, but whether He did or not, they weren't going to worship the idols. So, King Nebuchadnezzar and the whole world. By the way, at that time, the entire world found out about the true God of heaven, who He was and who His servants were through three people. And talking about the experience of the three Hebrew worthies, Ellen White makes very clear, I read it just last night or this morning, that history is going to be repeated. She's talking about the three Hebrew worthies. History is going to be repeated. Three people, in a very short time, the gospel of concerning the children of Israel, the kingdom of heaven, the Messiah, all that went to the whole world in just a very short time through three people. Things like that are going to happen again. We think, well, how are we going to? I've even heard preachers say, well, how are we going to get the gospel to the whole world? The babies are being born faster than we get the gospel out. Listen, God can solve that problem overnight. He did it with the three Hebrew worthies just overnight. Just now, it was more than overnight then. They had no telephone, telegraph, or anything like we had. So it took several days for it to go all over the world then. But it just took a matter of days. And everybody in the world knew about the God of heaven. They knew that He was above all earthly rulers and that those who refused to worship idols, that He could deliver them any way He chose. And things like that are going to happen again. In a very short time, today, it won't take days. It'll just be a matter of hours. People will know. They'll know about the three angels' message and what it means and who stands for it. They'll know. We don't know exactly how it will work out. Before that happened with the three Hebrew worthies, nobody imagined how the Lord would ever do such a thing, but He did it. Same thing happened again in the kingdom of Medo-Persia, when they threw Daniel in the lion's den. And the whole world found out in just a very short time that the God of heaven stands by His people. And if you're on the Lord's side, the Lord can deliver you in whatever way He chooses that is best. Look over to the book of Nahum. Nahum 1 and verse 7. It says, "The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and He knows those who trust in Him." He knows those that trust in Him. Okay, let's go to the New Testament And first of all, let's read what Jesus said about this problem. Because the disciples of Jesus sometimes had fear. And one of the things that you'll find out that when Jesus came on the scene, whatever the situation was, Jesus told his disciples to do not fear. Why didn't they need to fear? Because he was there. And if the Lord's with you, you don't need to fear. Now, Evelyn, what is the name of that pastor that we have with his materials? He started the Voice of the Martyrs. What was that man's name? I'm terrible with names. Richard Wurmbrand. He was a Lutheran pastor. And he was bold in proclaiming the gospel during when the communists were controlled the country, and in he spoke against what they were doing and in favor of civil rights in 1945 at a large Congress. And in 1947, he was kidnapped by the secret police, and he was in prison from 19 concentration camps of various kinds from 1947 until. Let's see, he was finally set free as a result of efforts of various Christians in other lands paid money to get him released in 1961. So he was in prison for about 14 years. And he wrote a book after he got out called Tortured for Christ. Evelyn and I got the book in about 1971. He formed an organization. Evelyn and I belong to this organization. In fact, their world headquarters is in Bartlesville, Oklahoma, called Voice of the Martyrs. And they're doing a marvelous work for persecuted Christians all over the world. And anyway, in writing this book, he tells what was going through his mind when they kidnapped him. I think he was on his way to his church that he was pastoring, walking there from home, and he was in a car stop, and of course it was a secret priest, and they just snatched him up, put him in the car, and took him away. His family didn't see him again for years. I get mixed up because I know another man that also had a similar experience in Bulgaria, and I can't keep all the country straight. He tells what was going through his mind when he was in this car. He'd just been kidnapped. He knew who kidnapped him. And he knew he didn't know what was going to happen to him. He knew he was in for trouble. But he tells what came to his mind. You know what came to his mind? Somehow, I don't know when it happened, in his study, he had found out that in the Bible, the Lord says, "Fear not," 366 times. He said he didn't say it 365 times. He said it once for every day of the year, even on leap year. And the Lord said in the Bible, "Fear not," 366 times. So he says, "I knew that was for me, and I didn't need to be afraid." And you don't need to be afraid if Jesus is with you. And if you're a commandment keeper, if you're following him and obeying him, you know that he'd be with you. And let's see what Jesus said about it. He says the persecutions are coming. He says they're going to deliver up to the councils and scourge you in the synagogues. That's Matthew 10, verse 17. He says, don't worry about what you're going to speak. It'll be given you what you're going to speak. That's verses 19 to 20. He talks about how the people in your family are going to deliver you up to death. That's in verse 21. He says, you're going to be hated by all for my name's sake. That's in verse 22. He says to flee. In other words, do not walk into temptation. Flee from the persecution if you can. And that's in verse 23. He said he went through the same thing for you. That's in verses 24 and 25. And then, starting in verse 26, he says, therefore do not fear them, for there is nothing covered that will not be revealed and hidden that will not be known. Whatever I tell you in the dark, speak in the light. And what you hear in the ear, preach on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in, the Greek word is Gehenna. That's hellfire. Are not two sparrows sold for a copper coin? I'm sure it is. I didn't have my Greek Bible here, so I should check it before I say for sure it's Gehenna, but I think that's the one that's used. There are a number of words in the King James Bible that translated hell. A common one is Hades, but the other one is Gehenna. Gehenna is, if you look in the Old Testament, it's the Valley of Hinnom. That's where they had burning piles outside of the city of Jerusalem. They burned garbage and so forth out of there. And since there was always burning out there, that became a symbol of hellfire. Are not two sparrows sold for a copper coin, and not one of them falls to the ground apart from your Father's will? But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. So, there's somebody watching and with you that knows everything about you. And it's not just the fact that you have somebody with you, but you have somebody with you that is all-powerful. That's very important to remember. You have somebody with you that's all-powerful. Ellen White talks about Martin Luther. And Martin Luther, of course, had to stand alone against the whole world. And it's very interesting to listen to some of the remarks. One time he said, I think it was to Worms, when he was going down there, he said, if there's more devils down there than there are tiles on the rooftops, I'm still going. Ellen White says he knew he had somebody with him that was mightier than them all. And we must have that same realization, that we have somebody with us that is all-powerful. And as long as we're doing His will, He's going to work it out. We can have confidence that no matter what happened, He's going to work it out. Look in Luke 21. Now, in Luke 21, I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but in inspired writings, now inspired writings agree with themselves, but they don't always seem to, because we have partial understanding. And so sometimes, this is very bothersome sometimes to baby Christians, that there are things in inspired writings that seem to totally contradict. And by the way, it'll be that way as long as we're in this world, because we don't have partial understanding. We just don't have partial understanding. So don't lose your faith in God because there's something in the Bible. There's two things in the Bible that seem to be directly contradictory. Here in Luke 21, there are some things that we can't really explain. But for instance, listen to these two verses. This might sound like a contradiction to you, but they're both in the Bible. They're almost real close together. One's verse 16 and one's verse 18. Jesus said, "You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relatives and friends, and they shall send some of you to your death." So, some of you are going to be put to death, Jesus said. But then notice what he says in verse 18. "But not a hair of your head shall be lost. In your patience possess your souls." Now, I don't try to explain things like that seem to be contradictory. How can you say that some of you are going to get put to death, but you're not going to lose a hair of your head? Well, just leave it in the Bible like it reads. Don't try to explain everything that you can't explain. And just trust the Lord. When you can't figure it out and you can't explain it, you don't have to explain everything. There are some people that have to explain everything. They're always in trouble when they read inspired writings. Look in 2 Corinthians. Now, this is a very interesting promise. Very interesting promise. That was given to the Apostle Paul. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, verses 7 to 10. It says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I am strong. So, how much grace are you going to need? I've heard people say, well, I don't know how I'm going to make it. I've heard their evidence is, well, I want to just die before the time of trouble comes because I can't make it. Listen, if you're weak, what does the text mean? All that means is that you just need more grace than somebody else that's not as weak as you are. But how much grace is there? Is there enough? There's enough grace. There's all the grace you need. Even if you're the weakest, there's all the grace that you need. All the grace that you need. And then here, this is one that is a favorite of many people. In 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, verses 12 and 13. It says, therefore let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond or above what you are able, but will with the temptation also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. What does that mean? Also make a way of escape, that you will be able to bear it. There are a lot of things that you and I don't understand because we haven't ever been through those type of temptations. But I'm going to read you a statement now from Signs of the Times, September 2, 1897, that's going to describe people that went through an experience that you and I have never had. One of the most painful ways that has ever been devised to destroy God's children was to burn them to death, burn them at stakes. And Ellen White talks about it repeatedly in her books, and it's in the Fox's Book of Martyrs, it's in Martyr's Mirror, it's in the History of Protestantism, it's in D'Aubigné's History of the Reformation, and all these historical books. And it's acknowledged by all the world that there are many people that were put to death in this manner. One of the most cruel methods has ever been devised to put a person to death. Now, Ellen White's going to tell you about the experience of the people that were burned to death at a stake. Here's what she says. She says, the martyrs knew what would lessen the fierceness of the fire kindling upon nerve and muscle. In beholding Christ in the manifestation of His presence, the most cruel death was made bearable. Now that's a very interesting statement, isn't it? What was it? What did they have? What did they get? In beholding Christ in the manifestation of His presence, the most cruel death was made bearable. You probably all have read the story. If you haven't, I didn't bring the book with me. I can tell you where it is. It's in Volume 1, Testimonies of the Church, page about 657. And Ellen White tells the experience of this experience was related by Jane Andrews, of a Christian that was sentenced to be burned to the stake. And there was a fellow Christian who was visiting him in prison. And this fellow Christian was of a fearful mind, and he was afraid, well, what is going to happen to me? If I'm a Christian too, I could get sentenced to be burned at the stake. My turn could come next. And as they talked, this Christian who was going to be burned at the stake told his friend, he said, listen, if the hope that I have in Christ is more powerful than the fire, I will give you a sign. And so it was agreed upon. And so the day came, and there was a huge crowd of people that assembled to watch. They executed people publicly in those days. That was to strike fear into everybody else so that they wouldn't do the same thing. That's the reason for it. So they had this public execution, and this man was bound to the stake, and they put the faggots around. That's like kindling. And they would stack them. If you've ever seen pictures, they would stack them up usually about shoulder height. They'd have faggots all around, all the way up about their shoulders, all the way around. And then they'd light them at the bottom, then they'd just burn up, and they'd burn the person in the process. And so this fellow Christian, the fire was lit, and he started to watch. And what is he watching for? He was watching to see if there was a sign. If he was going to get the sign that the hope that this man had in Christ was more powerful than the fire. And he watched, and he didn't see anything. And he kept watching, and he didn't see anything. And finally, the fire had burned so long that his arms were crisped, and people thought, well, he's dead. But just before he died, arms went straight up to heaven. And the man that was watching, he started to cry. He got the sign. He knew that the hope in Christ was more powerful right up to the end of life. It was more powerful than fire. And friend, if you and I go through and are ready to meet Jesus when He comes, we have to have that kind of faith. Now somebody might say, well, 144,000 aren't going to be put to death. Let me tell you something. Often being put to death isn't as terrible as the anticipation of being put to death. And the 144,000 are going to live under the anticipation of a death decree. We don't know how long it's going to be. That's the Lord's doing. I won't speculate on that. I've heard all kinds of preachers tell you how long it's going to be. So let the others tell you how long it's going to be. But they're going to live from the time the death decree is passed until the children of God deliver, they're going to live under that. And Ellen White says in the book Great Controversy that's actually now what even brings the suffering. If they could just have the assurance that everything's all right, then they wouldn't even hesitate if they were tortured or killed or whatever. The suffering they're going to endure is not the physical. The martyrs endured physical suffering, but the 144,000, the people that go through to the end, are going to have to endure mental suffering. Ellen White's very clear about this, that the suffering that they will endure is mental. Now, if you're a child, maybe it might seem to you like, no, that's no problem. But if you're an adult, you might understand that mental suffering can be just as bad, every bit as bad as physical suffering. But the Lord's grace is what will get you through that. It's not anything that you can just drum up in yourself. Here is one of my favorite ones. It's in both the Signs of the Times and the Review and Herald, but I'm going to quote it to you from the Review and Herald, June 9, 1910. It says, "Our divine Lord is equal to any emergency. With Him, nothing is impossible." Isn't that exciting? There is nothing impossible to the Lord, no matter what kind of a situation you're in. Now, I told you this morning that it says in the Bible that with God all things are possible. It states it both the positive and the negative. Let's look it up. Look in your Bible in Matthew 19, verse 26. Matthew 19, verse 26. It says, "But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." What's impossible with men? Well, what's impossible with men that a rich man could ever be saved? It's possible with God, it's impossible with men. But with God, He says, all things are possible. That's Matthew 19, 26. Okay, that's stating it positively. Now it can also be stated in the negative. Look in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. This has to do with the miracle birth again. Luke 1, 37. Matthew 19, 26 says that with God all things are possible. Luke 1, 37 says, "For with God nothing will be impossible." Nothing is impossible with God. If you trust Him, He can work anything out. This is the way Ellen White comments on this. "He has shown His great love for us by living a life of self-denial and sacrifice and by dying a death of agony. Come to Christ just as you are, weak, helpless, and ready to die. Cast yourself wholly on His mercy. There is no difficulty, within or without, that cannot be surmounted in His strength. Some have stormy tempers, but He who calmed the stormy sea of Galilee will say to the troubled heart, 'Peace be still.' There is no nature so rebellious that Christ cannot subdue it. No temper so stormy that He cannot quell it, if the heart is surrendered to His keeping." One time, there was a lady that was an artist. And this lady wrote a letter to Ellen White. And What she wanted Ellen White to do was to give her a few particulars. You see, Ellen White had seen the New Jerusalem in vision. Ellen White said one time, she said, if you could get one glimpse of the New Jerusalem, you would never want anything in this world again. And this lady wrote Ellen White, and she said she wanted Ellen White to give her a few particulars about the New Jerusalem, because she was an artist, and then she could paint a picture. Here's what Ellen White wrote back. She said, she asked me if I could not draw something of its plans. I wrote to her that I would have to say to her, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. No, said I, you cannot paint. You cannot picture, and the martyr tongue cannot begin to give any description of the glory of the future life. That's very significant. I'm going to let you think through what that means. She says, the martyr tongue cannot begin to give any description of the glory of the future life. But I will tell you what you can do. You can press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So, God hasn't promised us as we approach the final crisis that we're not going to have trials. He's told us that we will have trials. He hasn't promised us exemption from trials. But, if you look at the book, Mount of Blessings, page 30, Ellen White says that God has promised us something much better than exemption from trials. Here's what He's promised. He has said, as thy days, so shall thy strength be. We read that in the Bible. Where is it? Deuteronomy 33:25. My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. That's 2 Corinthians 12:9. And then she says this, if you are called to go through the fiery furnace for His sake, Jesus will be by your side, even as He was with the faithful three in Babylon. Isn't that exciting? You see, to go through to the end, we have to make a decision that we are going to obey God no matter what. So they can, the outside world, the government, the churches, whoever, can threaten anything. No matter what they threaten, our response is, we have to obey God rather than men. We will obey the laws of the land as long as they don't conflict with the laws of God, but if they conflict with the laws of God, we have to obey the law of God first. We have to do that no matter what. That's why the three Hebrew worthy said, well, we're not even careful to answer you about this, okay? We can't bow down to you. We can't bow down. We can't serve your gods, whatever you do. Our God can deliver us if He chooses, but well, whether He delivers us or not, we can't bow down to your gods. And no matter what, we can't do that. We have to make the same decision. We're going to go through the end. But it says, Jesus will be by your side even as He was with the faithful three in Babylon. Some people say, well, I'm just weak. I don't have very much courage. I don't have fortitude like the martyrs did. No, you don't. They didn't have it either till they needed it. The martyrs weren't any stronger than people today. They weren't stronger than we are. But the Lord can give you all the power and the strength you need at the right time. This is the way Ellen White describes it. Now, this is in the book, Our High Calling. That is also a Morning Watch book. It's a compilation of Ellen White writings. Page 125. This is what it says. We will not be able to meet the trials of this time without God. We are not to have the courage and fortitude of martyrs of old until brought into the position they were in. We are to receive daily supplies of grace for each daily emergency. Thus we grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, and if persecution comes upon us, if we must be enclosed in prison walls for the faith of Jesus and the keeping of God's holy law, as thy days, so shall thy strength be. Where was the text? Deuteronomy 33:25. Should there be a return of persecution, there would be grace given to arouse every energy of the soul to show a true heroism. So, with the trials will come divine power to deal with the trials. The three Hebrew worthies were required on pain of death to bow down to the idols, and they said, we won't do it. We won't do it even if we die, whatever happens, we won't do it. And Ellen White is commenting on this in 1897 in the Signs of the Times, and she says, force is the last resort of every false religion. At first it tries attraction, as the king of Babylon tried the power of music and outward show. If these attractions invented by men inspired by Satan failed to make men worship the image, the hungry flames of the furnace were ready to consume them. So it will be now. The papacy has exercised her power to compel men to obey her, and she will continue to do so. We need the same spirit that was manifested by God's servants in the conflict with paganism. Then she says, it is in the power of God alone that we shall be enabled to be loyal to Him. So, the promise is, wherever you go, He'll be with you. I think actually it was the Bulgarian pastor that I read about who was in a communist concentration camp, and they told him, because he refused to do what they wanted him to do, they told him, they said, we're going to throw you in this dungeon, and you're just going to rot there. That's going to be it. And they put him in there. There was no light. Now, if you've never been in an experience like that, let me explain a little bit about how the human body and mind works. This is true even for people who have been in Alaska or places where the sun doesn't shine. Your body has what we call diurnal rhythms, circadian rhythms. They're 24-hour patterns in your body. And these patterns respond to light. So all kinds of hormones and electrical charges in your nervous system are controlled by the periodicity of light and dark. And so we don't ever think about this because every morning the sun comes up and the evening the sun goes down. And deep in the eye we have a gland called the pineal gland. And it responds to light. And it responds to light and it causes many different changes to take place in the body as in a response to light. And so you have this exposure to light in the daytime and then the light goes out at the nighttime. And for those of you that are interested in physiology, circadian rhythms are extremely interesting subject to study. And it's extremely interesting that they've tried all kinds of experiments with these things by putting people in artificial situations and changing the amount of light and dark and the number of hours of light and the number of hours of dark. But when you're put into a dungeon like that and it's totally pitch dark all the time, one of the things that happens is you lose total consciousness of time. You have no idea about the time. Now, eventually, if you don't know anything about time and you don't, you know, have you been in there a day, a week, a month, a year, 5 years, 10, you don't know. You don't have any watch, you don't have any way to keep track of time, and you have no idea about how long you've been where. And this can drive a person insane. Of course, that's the point. That's why people are put in places like that. It will absolutely drive you insane when you lose total contact. We think that we don't know time, but the body keeps track of time all the time. It's my personal belief. This is just my personal belief, and so you don't need to believe it. But it is my personal belief that Adam and Eve didn't need a watch or a clock or anything like that, because in their body they knew what time it was. You have these rhythms in your body, and if everything's working right, you know exactly what time it is. It's very interesting how this works in animals. I've met a number of people. Some friends. We were at visiting their house a few days ago, and they have a little tiny dog about this high, and it's a house dog. And the man of the house told me, he says, I don't ever sleep in. He says, because I feed this dog at 7 o'clock in the morning. He said, when 7 o'clock in the morning comes, he said, it's not hardly a minute off. Just immediately, right on the dot at 7 o'clock, if I'm in bed, this dog come wake me up. Time for him to get food. So animals don't have a clock. They don't know how to read. They know time. And I personally believe that in the in the beginning, Adam and Eve didn't need a clock, or they knew, and they knew what time it was. Their body told them what time it was. But when you're in a dungeon like that, you lose contact with time. And that when you lose contact with time, you lose contact with reality. And finally, this man tells of his experience. He's down there. They would hand him once or twice a day some food and water, and that was it. He was down there in the dark, total darkness. And he said, finally, he lost reality. He didn't know what time it was. And he said, I thought I was going to go crazy. Because I said, I didn't know whether I was down there a day, a week, a month, a year, how long. I didn't know. I had no idea. And when he was felt like he was just going to lose it mentally, he said, I saw light. You read in the Bible, the Lord, wherever God is, there is light. He saw light, and the light came closer. And when the light came close, he says, it was a person. And he said, the person picked me up and just held me for a while. And he said, after he held me for a while, I was all right. The devil can never put you in a place where the Lord won't be with you if you're one of God's children. And that's one of the wonderful things about being one of God's children. The devil's children don't have that assurance. But if you're one of God's children, if you're one of the Lord's children, you have the assurance that the devil and his agents can never, ever put you in a place where God won't be with you and where he won't hear your prayers. It can never happen. Commenting on that, Ellen White says, that God who walked with the three Hebrew children in the fiery furnace, who protected Daniel in the lion's den, who manifested himself to John on the lonely island, will go with you wherever you go. His abiding presence will comfort and sustain you. In closing, I want to read just a few exciting and precious promises from this little book, My Life Today. This book is loaded. I guess all the Ellen White books are loaded. But this book has some really exciting promises in it. And here's one. On page 302, and this is the book, My Life Today. I have seen the tender love that God has for his people, and it is very great. I saw angels over the saints with their wings spread above them, about them. Each saint had an attending angel. If the saints wept through discouragement or were in danger, the angels that ever attended them would fly quickly upward to carry the tidings, and the angels in the city would cease to sing. They would bear the tidings upward, and all the angels in the city would weep, and then with a loud voice say, Amen. But if the angels fixed their eye, but if the saints fixed their eyes upon the prize before them and glorified God by praising him, then the angels would bear the glad tidings to the city, and the angels in the city would touch their golden harps and sing with a loud voice, Alleluia, and the heavenly arches would ring with their lovely songs. One of the things that God's children have learned, there are two things that God's children that have learned that I've read their experiences who have been put in these concentration camps and dungeons and so forth. One is, if you want God to be helpful, to help you, you need to praise the Lord. Even if you're in a dungeon, you need to praise the Lord. Yeah, have you read the story of what happened with Paul and Silas when they were in the dungeon, in the prison? What were they doing? They're praising the Lord. That's one thing. A second thing I learned reading about their experiences is that you need to be thankful. You need to be thankful. You need to thank God for whatever you can think of to be thankful, because as you are thankful to the Lord, you will find your situation gets better. I didn't read all this page. Here's a couple other paragraphs on this same page, page 302, that are really exciting. A guardian angel is appointed to every follower of Christ. These heavenly watchers shield the righteous from the power of the wicked one. This Satan himself recognized when he said, doth Job fear God for naught? Hast not thou made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? The agency by which God protects his people is presented in the words of the psalmist. The angel of the Lord encamps round about them that fear him and delivers them. That's Psalm 34. His angels are appointed to watch over us. And if we put ourselves under their guardianship, then in every time of danger, they will be at our right hand. Isn't that good? When unconsciously we are in danger of exerting a wrong influence, the angels will be by our side, prompting us to a better course, choosing words for us, and influencing our actions. Thus, our influence may be a silent, unconscious, but mighty power in drawing others to Christ and the heavenly world. That's page 302. Here's another really exciting one on page 316. Yeah, page 316. It says, the enemy cannot overcome the humble learner of Christ, the one who walks prayerfully before the Lord. Christ interposes himself as a shelter, a retreat from the assaults of the wicked one. I didn't give you that Bible text. If there's those of you that don't know it, I better give it to you quick so you can look it up and you can have it. That's an allusion, actually. What she's saying is an allusion to Isaiah 32:2. The promise is given, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Satan was permitted to tempt the too confident Peter as he had been permitted to tempt Job, but when that work was done, he had to retire. Had Satan been suffered to have his way, there would have been no hope for Peter. He would have made complete shipwreck of faith. But the enemy dare not go one hairbreadth beyond his appointed sphere. There is no power in the whole satanic force that can disable the soul that trusts in simple confidence in the wisdom that comes from God. Isn't that wonderful? That's exciting. If you trust in God and you put yourself in His care and chosen to follow Him, there is nothing in the whole satanic force that can disable you. Christ is our tower of strength, and Satan can have no power over the soul that walks with God in humility of mind. The promise is, let him take hold of my strength that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. In Christ, there is perfect and complete help for every tempted soul. Dangers beset every path, but the whole universe of heaven is standing on guard that none may be tempted above that which is able to bear. Some have strong traits of character that will need to be constantly repressed. If kept under the control of the Spirit of God, these traits will be a blessing. But if not, they will prove a curse. If we will give ourselves unselfishly to the work, never swerving in the least from principle, the Lord will throw about us the everlasting arms. Now that's allusion to Deuteronomy 33 that we read. And will prove a mighty helper. If we will look to Jesus as the one in whom we may trust, He will never fail us in any emergency. Isn't that exciting? He'll never fail you in any emergency. Well, some people say, how much help can you receive? You will receive all the help that you need. In fact, it'll be plenty. Ellen White in Signs of the Times, September 2, 1897, wrote this assurance about the help you receive. It says, God's grace will be given in every way proportionate to the trial suffered to come upon us. Christ has promised, I will manifest myself to him. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. That's John 14. And again, he comforts us with the words, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. In the Lord there is perfect and complete help for every tried and tempted soul. Are you happy about it? You know, friends, we should claim these promises, memorize them, and go to the Lord and say, Lord, thank you for promising me these things. I'm trusting that you are going to get me through anything that comes. And how do you know God is going to get you through the trial you have in the future? Because He's giving you the help that you need to get through the trial that you have today. And because you have the help that you need to get through the trial today, you know that you'll have the help that you need to get through the trial that comes to you in the future. Let's pray before we depart. Father in heaven, we thank you for the abundant, precious promises that you have given to us. We thank you that you have appointed and sent an angel to be a guardian to each one of your children, and that they are near at hand, that they have constant and complete communication and contact with the heavenly universe, and can bring to us any help that we need at any time. We thank you for these wonderful promises. We pray that you will help each one of us, that we may become strong in faith, that we may trust you in every circumstance, and that no matter what threatening that the devil does to try to terrify us, that we may have that trust in you, that confidence to know that nothing can happen but what you can get us through it. Help us to have this perfect faith and trust in you. And we pray that each one of us, day by day, the little trials and troubles that we go through, that you will help us to be learning the lesson of trusting in you, trusting in our Savior, knowing that he will take us through and he will provide us all the help we need. Help each one of us that we'll learn the lesson. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.